Hello, everyone. Welcome to Title 24, presented by NBC Sports, Episode 9. Myself, Ricky Carmichael, and of course, Ryan Villopoto here coming to you. It's going to be a good one. We got a really special show, a special guest here today. But before we bring him on, I want to thank United Motorsports, Boxo USA, and of course, Quadlock. We appreciate you guys. But man, really, really, really excited to have this guy on the show. None other than the winner of round 14 of AMA Monster Energy Supercross, the man of the hour, Justin Barcia. What's up, JB?
What's up, boys? Thanks for having me on. Ricky, when you asked me, I was like, Ricky, RV, you kidding me? That's a legendary group. And, you know, to do an interview with you guys and be on the podcast, absolutely epic. So thanks.
Yeah, dude.
No, thanks for coming on. I know it's a busy travel schedule. Not so much for you guys, but everybody's coming home on Sunday. And yeah, it was so glad to have you on.
Yeah. Hey, so, I mean, we talked about it a little bit on the broadcast, and dude, ever since I would say Daytona, I mean, you have been a completely different guy. Your performances have been absolutely unbelievable, riding up front week in, week out, and you've been coming from behind and working your way up to the front as well. And, you know, you're knocking down the thirds, then you're knocking down seconds, and eventually those are going to come, those are going to become wins. You got it done. You could clearly see it was super emotional. Just walk us through that moment and what was going through your head and when you realized, hey, I can win this dang thing.
Yeah, for sure. It was incredible. Yeah, like you said, Daytona time. It was all year. I was really comfortable. My program was good. Just took a little bit longer than I would like to get super comfortable with the bike and the changes and stuff. But we found a setting, Daytona, missed out on the podium there, unfortunately. But then we just started clicking them off. And the only thing I was lacking was starts. The starts obviously keep getting better and better and better. We're finding things. So that's good. And then, yeah, this weekend, I mean, well, this past weekend, it was insane. Practice was good, feeling really comfortable, rain or shine. I never thought about the rain all day. I was just like, the track is what it is right now. If the rain comes, so be it. I'm a good mud rider, obviously. So, yeah, I was for it and just wanted to, you know, go out there, rain or dry and send it. And that's what I've been doing. And my mentality has just been ride smart, but my speed's been really good. So that puts me in great positions to charge through the pack and do what I have to do. But, yeah, the feelings, you know, I knew I had to – got a pretty good start. It came out like I ended up taking a lead quite quick. And yeah, I striked early because you don't want to be on that roofs and that mud, and got a big old lead, and the last lap was insane. Just cruised and celebrated with the fans, and was quite emotional. I think that was one of my more special ones for sure, and hopefully I keep stacking these things up.
Yeah, no, that's it's great to see, man. Like, I mean, I just have to jump in and ask you a question. What do you think the success is coming from GasGas versus like Honda? You know, like, I, from the outside looking in, I look at GasGas as like a factory team, but also a boutique style. You know, it's not this huge team. They don't have a huge manpower behind them, but they have a great program behind them. The bike's working. I mean, I've said this before, even you coming on the show. To me, this is the best season you've had in 450, I think, probably ever. All the years that I got to race you and then I retired. And now it seems like, you know, you're really coming into your own and, you know, probably riding, in my opinion, the best you've rode ever in the 450 class.
Yeah, you know, thank you very much. I think all the there's always puzzle pieces in this thing and they all come together right now, you know. Maybe having the kid, obviously, that's a lot of hard. It's a lot more hard work, less sleep, stuff like that. I mean, you guys know. I mean, you shouldn't really be better and having the best season you've had. But, you know, it just, you know, when you wake up in the morning, you see your kid, it makes you happy. Go to work, it makes you happy when you get home. So that's cool. The team, there's been a lot of changes. You know, Ollie my mechanic went to crew chief, which has been super positive. He's a hard worker. He honestly, getting the seconds and thirds, he was kind of not happy. And that, in a way, for me, I liked that because it showed me this dude wants to win. So other people are like, oh, he's just not that happy about, you know, the second and thirds. And I'm like, we're happy about it, but we want to win. So this weekend when we won, to see his smile, that made me really happy. So Ollie crushing it, you know, Troy's son, Max, is running the team now. And that's, man, that's huge to take on. Max has adapted to that really well. My mechanic, he's doing a great job. He's from New York. So that was sick that we got the win in Jersey. He was really, that was his first win. So that was rad. But all in all, I think just the team in general, Troy Lee himself, I mean, when I got that first win in Texas a couple of years ago, it's been 2 years now, Troy was like, my life's made. I could die tomorrow, he said. And like, dude, that Troy, he has epic stories, and he's lived an amazing life, and he's going to live a lot more amazing years. So that was super special. He's just super passionate about it. And, you know, obviously we don't have the most money or the biggest budget, but we have Austria behind us, KTM Husky. And we're the third brand. And, but I'm thinking we're the first brand right now, you know, obviously Coop's in the championship fight, but, it's just a good vibe over there. It's a lot of fun. I brought a new trainer on this year, my guy Brady. I brought Sorby in. So it's not about, we all put in the work. We all do the stuff. You guys set the bar back in the day for us to, you know, have to work hard and do that stuff. I love that stuff, but it's more about the good feelings and having good people around you. And to be honest with you, I think it's just the vibe. It's really good. And obviously when I had speed and all that, and then when I started putting it up front, the confidence went up and everything's just clicking.
Nice. That's really cool, man. Like, yeah, I've seen Sorby, you know, I think has come in a couple different times throughout your career, correct?
Yeah. Sorby's always been around for sure. He's always helps me out. We always talk, and now he moved to Florida though, so he's not as far away. And it was just like, it just worked out. He's helping Vial out a bit. And he's actually kind of moving forward a little. And now he's going to be at the Bakers. He's doing stuff there. So, Yeah.
Hey, like, what does he help you with? Like, I mean, give us an explanation, because I'm curious too. Like, I mean, I know you've worked with Stanton along the way, which, dude, I think that guy's epic. He's great. I put him alongside. I mean, you know my relationship with Osho. I mean, I feel like he's right there with Johnny. Does Eric do stuff like that for you at the race, or is he not quite that involved?
Yeah, it's different. Like you said, you know, I've worked with Osho, I've worked with Stanton. I love those guys. I respect them more than anything. They're such hard workers. They set the bar for us. And I'm still, you know, friends with those guys and can talk to those guys and have fun and reach out if I need something. But Sorby, it's just different. We've always just had this click. Like, I met him in Paris back in the day, probably 2010, 11. And we've just always been friends. And it's just this click we have. And he'll come back from practice and he's like, he's kind of puts his hands up and he's like, great, dude. Like, I don't really have much to tell you. They'll have something here or there, like, oh, they're doing this rhythm or this, but he doesn't try to tell me to change my riding. He just tries to kind of help me adapt to things. And it's more of just a happy vibe. And it's like having a friend around, which is kind of, He's a friend of mine. So that's really it.
Yeah.
No secret, you know?
Yeah. For people tuned in who don't know Eric Sorby, Eric Sorby is a French rider. He's really good racer. In his time, he rode for Pro Circuit Kawasaki for a little bit, a couple other teams within the industry, but he's got a long history of racing. He's worked with some great guys. So for the people tuning in today and listening, that's Eric Sorby, great guy, fun to be around for sure. And it's cool to see him to be back in the industry. You know, one thing that I've always wanted to ask you this, and I don't know why that I've never asked you this, but we always talk about, like, we're talking about championship and stuff like that, like breaking it down, like, man, this guy's good in these conditions, or this is where this guy struggles. I'm trying to think of a track where, like, I feel like you excel at all tracks. Like, you're right there. You ride the same level at every track. Are there certain conditions that you look forward to racing in? Like, we got three more races left. Of these three rounds, which would be your favorite? And what is your favorite condition?
Good question. I'm glad you asked me that, because this year has been a little bit of a turn for me, because I'd like to think I've never been the greatest hard pack guy, because I like to, you know, hit the throttle hard and give it the beans, you know. It's just my style. But this year I've made a really good change and adapted to all the conditions, which I'm really happy about that, because I think future, this is like, I've always I want to win championships, and I still have years in my career. So, but this year there's been a change to now the future. I feel like I'll be able to compete for these championships this year. Obviously in the beginning of the season, I didn't put myself in the best positions, but you know, future now I can hopefully do that. But yeah, my favorite conditions are kind of like a Southwick. I think that always, you know, obviously that's motocross and we're talking about supercross, but somewhere where I can hold it, you know, wide open hard and go at it. But this year, like I said, the turning point's been good. I've been able to ride the hard pack and the bike setup really works on that stuff and the wet. So I think I'm quite actually excited about like Salt Lake City, you know, because I've built my confidence up to ride that hard pack stuff. So get some hole shots towards the end of the season and send it on that hard pack. I know I can ride it good and I'm excited for that challenge.
No, that's really cool to hear, you know, and I have to also say, like, you know, the last few rounds we've seen it early in the season, you know, like sticking your nose in the front of the bike in some areas that's questionable. And we got to watch last weekend where really smart decisions, and I'm sure there were some openings. We kind of heard it on some press throughout the week, you know, like, yeah, I feel like you're riding and racing smarter too, which is helping you in the end now to put yourself in good positions and, you know, just keeping your nose out of the mud when need be. Now we all know that you have it in you to shove it in there and throw it in there when needed, but really, really cool to see the confidence and you being able to ride without being, oh yeah, that's a nice one on Chase right there coming up the inside, you know, but that's total racing. That's not there's Justin again. That's just, hey, yeah. I'm going to the front. It's muddy. These are dire situations right now. I would have done the same move right there.
Yeah. I think that's like, walk us through that pass. Like, and for the record, I think the one on Chase, I mean, dude, you barely tapped him. And to RV's point, you have to do that in that position. And like right there, you didn't even make, I don't even think you made contact there, but you have to do that in a mud race, right? I mean, you have to.
Yeah, you would have never done that in a dry race. The speed would have been way higher and it would have been probably both of us going down. So yeah, I think I appreciate you guys saying that because, you know, I've worked hard at being a better racer this year. And I wish I could have figured this out a lot earlier in my career, but sometimes just things don't work that way. But yeah, this year I've really worked on myself trying to be a better racer and it just shows. And I'm stoked you guys think that pass was good. And like I said, it's early in the race, had to go for it. I feel like I kind of did the same pass on Kenny. We saw it on the replay, but I don't think Chase, you know, he should have maybe expected that. Yeah. He could have looked down a little quicker. Kenny was definitely more aware of me coming up. So, yeah, that was a good pass. I would do that over and over again for sure. But yeah, I've definitely the better riding, you know, let my speed do the passes. And, you know, I love block passing and doing that stuff, but there's a fine line between too much and there's a time
and a place for it. And that was the time and the place.
Yeah. Dude, I mean, I even think like on the broadcast, I mean, you had to do it and that where you were at in the race, how the conditions were, I think it was perfect. I think you executed it perfect. And to Ryan's point, yeah, the last several weeks, I mean, your etiquette has been awesome and look how well you're doing. I think that's just a testament to, you know, how far you've come and along in your career, especially these last several races. And man, it's just now you've got to win. And I'm sitting here thinking, so you've won at a young age, dude, you had so much success as an amateur. Then you come up as a hot rookie in supercross and motocross. You won in the 250 level, you've won in the 450 level. And now that you're older, you have a beautiful family and your son, do you feel like the wins mean more now than they ever have in the past?
Yeah. Yeah. The wins are definitely that one felt so good. And it's been a while. And, you know, you through your career, like you know, for me, I went, like you said, really good amateur career, and then, you know, good 250 stuff, and then 450s. It was like I always had the speed, but it was never, you know, putting stuff together. And at one, like, you know, you guys know, at one point I was kind of like, yeah, I don't know if this is really for me anymore. You know, I went through a lot of bad times and places, and then, you know, sorted my life out, and we're back to this position. So I didn't know if the wins were going to come again. I obviously, you know, wanted that, and now to be in this position, yeah, they feel way bigger, way better. And now I feel like there's a lot more going to come. And, you know, me and Amber were talking on the way home, you know, we had, you know, a couple hour drive, and we're like, there's no reason why I can't win these last three races. Like, my speed's good. My starts are better, and they're just been keeping getting better. I'm being more consistent, so I'm gonna give their boys a run for their money for sure, and definitely podiums, and that win, you know, get that one win, and now let's stack up, you know, three more wins, and then we're on to, you know, motocross, and then the super motocross. So there's a lot more time to get wins, and I'm excited.
No, that's good, man. That's good. Yeah, sitting putting yourself in a great position for super motocross as a contender for the playoffs, you know, coming in super strong there. I got one more question for you. Do you think that was, I was watching the rain come down. Obviously we had the delay and everybody had to go inside the tunnel, but when we went up to watch the lights race, I was like, you know what, I know it kept raining all the way through both main events, but it wasn't one of the worst mud races I've seen. I feel like the track actually held up pretty well for a while. It got definitely a lot worse for you guys, but you guys were still able to jump the finish most of the main event. The triple also, Kenny was tripling on and onto the tabletop in the one rhythm section after the first turn. So did you think it was I know it's probably towards the end of the main event, it definitely got way more treacherous, but how was the mud compared to I guess a really gnarly mud race? Do you think it was really gnarly?
No, I don't think it was really gnarly. You know, we were still blitzing the whoops, doing the triples for over halfway through. The finish line was the hardest thing that, you know, we did that until halfway as well, and maybe even a couple of times after that. So all in all, not the worst mud race ever, and there was options to take different lines to make passes. So all in all, that kind of makes me feel better about my win as well, because, you know, people are like, oh, it was muddy, that's why he won, but not really. You know, it was, I think, like Ricky said, it was going to happen no matter what, but you know, mud, so be it. That's mud's your butt, as my old mechanic Schneik would say. So, but yeah, no, it wasn't one of the worst. It definitely got harder as the race went on, because it got stickier, and we got down to plywood in a lot of places. So you had to be smart on the throttle, but all in all, no, you guys have raced way, way worse mud races than that.
Well, and sure. I think it makes it almost worse in the side of, like, if it's a true mud race, everybody's rolling everything. But now the technical side of it being like, okay, dude, we still got to jump the finish. Kenny's doing the rhythm section. We still got to jump the triple. So for the fans,
you're racing. You're still racing. You're not surviving. You're racing the track.
You're racing the track in the mud to jump all those jumps. So it gets gnarly. Like, you know, I've been in that position before, and you're just like, okay, another lap, let's get the finish over. Okay. Am I going to be able to jump it next lap? Let's see.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, Kenny doing that three onto the tabletop, I actually never pulled the trigger on that. I just wasn't, you know, comfortable with it. And Kenny was, you know, he had a little bit, I wouldn't say bad luck, well, kind of bad luck. He had to pull his goggles. So that cost him a lot. So I built a gap up before that, but all in all, he was definitely riding really well in that stuff, doing some rhythms that I guess I just wasn't willing to do, which also I kind of like give a pat on my back. I'm getting smarter and in my old age, I guess. So this is all good stuff.
You're aging like fine wine, my man. That's good stuff. Before we let you go, first and foremost, congratulations on the win this past weekend in New Jersey. That was an epic ride. It was well-deserved. You could see it coming. Congratulations on your two-year extension. That's fantastic. And, believe in yourself, dude. You can win. You could win out. You've got the speed. There's no reason you can't do it. You got these guys in a great spot. They're kind of the top three guys are riding protective. But at the same time, even though they're riding protective, you have the downright speed to do it. And you've proven that the last five races. So great job. Thank you for coming on Title 24 with RV and I. It's definitely special to have you on, and best of luck for the rest of the championship.
Nah, you kidding me? You guys are awesome. And getting words like this from you two, you honestly have no idea what that means to me. I respect you guys a ton. Stoked on the show. This is epic that you guys are doing this, and it's going to be a fun rest of the year, and I'll be seeing you guys soon at the races.
Man, it was great to have Justin on. So now we get to roll on and break down East Rutherford, and a lot of firsts for me, RV. I've never had to wait out a lightning storm. We got dry conditions. We got wet conditions. You were there yeah. Checking it all out, checking the action. So I think the biggest stories is Eli one outside of Justin winning, but Eli's wreck. Did you think he was going to remount and finish where he did?
You know, I did.
Really?
Think he was. Yeah, I did think he was going to remount. You know, right here we're showing, watching the replay. Hand slips right off. Just a. I don't know. I don't want to say careless mistake. Just a very awkward mistake, and it happened to be the throttle hand. As we're watching this replay, it looks like he jammed his. It ton of bricks just kind of came down as he just, you know, pile drove into the ground. So you can watch him limping off the track here. We're watching the replay for the folks that aren't watching replay, that are listening, you know, and headed back to the pits. You know, that's something that nobody wants to see. And being in his position, you know, you can see they're just really, really holding the right knee, limping off the track. I know that the word is through the pits is there provisional rules still, because he didn't even make a lap in this one, but he was able to come out and practice two and put some on the board right there. Just watch that right leg just slam down to the ground and you know, probably a Charlie horse or a dead leg, you know, but he was able to come back out, get some laps on the board. I think he went to the gate pick for qualifying around sixth or seventh.
Yeah.
You know, and, had a good qualifier. So yes, I knew he's a champion. He's tough. This, you know, we've talked about how narrow it is to stay up on top of that mountain. And this is how you win championships, is on your bad days. Eli can win. And I think will win based off of that performance just there, because it's gnarly to come back after a crash like that and being in his position.
You know, and another thing, and you know how this is like, so I'm looking at it now. He's got an 11-point lead over Coop, and we'll role play a little bit here. So if Coop wins every single race, there you go, showing the points right here. Eli Tomac, he has 315 total points, 7 wins. Cooper Webb's 11 back. Sexton is 21 back. That's going to be really tough to come from. He's just about eliminated from this point, especially guys against someone like Eli Tomac or Cooper Webb. But if we role play here and you talk about, okay, if Cooper wins and Eli gets second, because I don't see Eli getting anywhere further than one spot behind Cooper. He still wins. Let's see, 3, 6, 9. So he'll have what, 2-point buffer. That's if Cooper won and Eli got second. Dude, when it gets to that situation, you pretty much got it in the bag, unless there's some foreseen deal that happens. If he gets hurt, obviously anything can happen. We saw what happened to Eli, but man, those mistakes rarely happen. And I'm with you. I think he takes it from this point on. I can't see Cooper beating him the next three rounds and Eli finishing no more than one or two spots behind him.
Yeah, it's a tough spot to be in, I think, for being for Coop, for you know, coming in after we had a mud race, you know, this last weekend. And obviously, that's anybody's game. It definitely levels the playing field. Anything can happen with the mud. But I think it's a tough position for Coop to be in. And why I say that is we're coming down to three rounds left, and you know, the last previous two weekends have not gone as well as Coop had wanted. You know, only made up 1 point the weekend before. And now was lost a couple points in this one. So with three to go, I think he's probably thinking, you know, I don't want to say spinning his wheels, but how is he going to get back up on that horse? And with being 11 down, it's pretty critical that he comes out swinging these last three, but also he needs a little bit of a favor, you know, and yeah. I don't see that favor coming, because Eli is too consistent. He's too good. I think that Eli is, and also too smart. So I think that, and Eli's getting some great starts. He's had great starts all year. Now, if this would be his Cowie days where he was very inconsistent up and down with his starts, I think that Coop would have a better shot. But right now, Eli's just – he's super consistent with his starts, and he's putting himself in a great position every weekend.
Yeah, Fowler, Clinton Fowler from Fowler Facts. I mean, dude, to your point on the starts, Eli has the best average finish or average start compared to anyone in the field, which is so gnarly, complete turnaround from his Cowie days. I think his average first lap is 3.6 or 3.9. So to your point, I mean, when he's that good and every part of his game is that good, yeah, it's going to be tough. Anything can happen. And I think like for Mother Nature, it's supposed to rain. There's a chance, a pretty high chance of rain this weekend in Nashville. But once we get back going, when we go to Denver, I mean, the likelihood of it being a mudder is slim. And then, of course, Salt Lake. I mean, definitely the percentage of rain is of no rain is on the rider's side. So if you're Eli Tomac, you got to be thinking, okay, if I can dodge one more bullet this weekend in Nashville, as far as Mother Nature goes, I'm sitting pretty.
Yep. And then we go to Salt Lake, and it's altitude. You know, we all know Eli comes from altitude, and I can tell you that being sea level, either if I was based in Florida or, you know, like I was based in Florida, or if I was out in California, we're at sea level out here. So I can tell you that every time we go to Colorado for either outdoors or go to Utah for Supercross, that definitely affects the riders. It always affected me. I was able to push through it, but Eli's got a better foundation, better base at that altitude. So, and that comes down to the last round. So what better scenario to have for Eli to come into Utah with that altitude on his side, because it is on his side. I promise you that.
Yeah, that was a great point. I completely forgot about that. Yep, absolutely. And then, I mean, those Yamahas, I mean, even the 250s, we know how fast they are. And then the 450s, I feel like Eli's bike, that thing rips. So that's certainly going to help going into altitude as well when you have an engine advantage. So, dude, 250 showdown, east-west showdown. What's your takeaways? Did you think Anstie was going to bag that?
Dude, love his interviews. Every interview he's had this year is, I mean, if anybody, I wish I could take some lessons from him. Everybody else that's on the gate should take right? some lessons.
Honestly, from about the third lap in, I was just thinking, man, this bonus check's going to be quite good. Uribe, I'm going to tip him upside down and empty him out. And I thought, man, I better not screw this up now. I better keep my, you know, keep hitting my marks. And then I just thought back to, I'm the best mud rider there is. You know, 2017 Motocross Nation. I thought, I got this.
Man, they gave him the microphone up on the podium after, you know, and I know that's his first win, but man, the kids never got, or the guys never short on words. And it's very awesome to listen to him do a podium interview, but led start to finish, man, put himself in a great position, was able to get the whole shot and led wire to wire. You know, so really cool to see those guys able to get their very first win in the lights class himself, and Max get his very first win also. You know, that was really cool to see.
Did you think that one of the Lawrence brothers were going to win? Like, I mean, obviously once it started to rain, that throws a wrench in things, but did you have one of those guys as the favorite?
Honestly, I figured Jet was probably going to be, you know, definitely up front potentially, or more than likely win that. I wasn't seeing it coming from, Anstie wasn't on my radar, but as soon as he pulled the whole shot, I was like, who's on the white Honda out front?
Yeah.
And then, somebody spoke over my shoulder and said, oh, this Anstie. And I was like, oh, coming from Europe, we know how well he rides in sand. We know how well he rides in mud, and in those treacherous conditions. So when he was out front like that, I was just, if his bike stays running, I think that he was going to win. Jet was on the move. I feel like Hunter was riding a little bit tentative, par for the course of, you know, champ, his very first Supercross championship right at the cusp of him. But man, it was great racing. And I think the story of other than Max is Hampshire coming in into the last turn right before checkered flag. You know, Jet made a mistake coming out of the turn before the whoops. Seat looks over his shoulder, and here comes Hampshire just blasting in there.
It happens so fast.
My question is, man, I'm glad, or, you know, I'm sure everybody is looking at it, and for the hydroplane kind of coming in and washing the front, like the speed, look at the smile on his face. Oh, you know, the speed, if he wouldn't have laid it down. Yeah. Look at him there. It's mud.
I don't
everywhere.
Know if he's smiling, bro. I don't you, know.
You know, like the speed coming in there, I feel like that was a bit misjudged, because if he wouldn't have laid it down, it would have been very ugly for Jet. Because he was coming in there with way more entry speed to that turn, and they definitely would have collided at the wrong spot if RJ wouldn't have laid it down earlier.
Yeah, that actually came, and you started talking about this, but there's a guy, one of our followers and fans of Title 24, he asked, he's like, what did you make of Deegan and Hampshire's kamikaze style overtake attempts? Where's the line between hard racing and recklessness? So, I mean, you kind of answered it. Do you feel like it was reckless? Do you feel like it was reckless?
I thought so. To Deegan was riding like a little bit, you know, call it kamikaze, but Haiden was riding very well. He actually put her down on the ground and then was able to catch back up and kind of catch those guys. So he was riding, you know, very well. You know, there he goes, lays it down, and he was able to recover after this, which, you know,
he caught back up.
He did catch back up. So his mud skills are on. They're on par with the best of them. You know, that one there definitely could have been questionable, but, you know, none of the guys made it to Jet or Hunter. So we can say woulda, shoulda, coulda, or all the buts or ifs and ands. It never happened. But I do think if RJ would have connected with Jet there would have probably been some words from AMA after, because, man, he was coming in 3, 4, 5 miles an hour, a lot, like tremendously a lot faster. And the connection point would have been probably very, very aggressive.
Dude, that would have been if RJ would have kept it upright, to your point, not hydroplaned, it would have, I mean, I wonder, I'd love to ask him, like, if he anticipated it being that coming in that fast, because clearly he couldn't stop, you know, when he hit he hit the mud. He could have hurt himself as well coming in that fast. I'm gonna give him the benefit of the doubt that he wasn't planning on coming in that fast.
And maybe he didn't, because you could see he was trying to kind of scrub some screed, get that bike turned, but as he came in, it just the front wheel just took a set and it just stayed in one position and it just pushed all the way in there.
I want to go
for Jet. He got lucky.
I want to go back to one thing that you were saying about Max Anstie, and we talked about this before we started recording, is the celebrations and how you think it's cool how these guys are celebrating, and like how Justin Barcia celebrated after the win, how a guy like Max Anstie celebrates for the win. You went out there, you won. You didn't celebrate a whole bunch. It didn't seem like you cared about getting the fans too into it. But now it seems like when these guys win, I mean, they are just absolutely getting so stoked and having that fan interaction.
I love to see it. You know, I brought this up, prior to the show, and you can see Justin right here with his win celebration. Honestly, Coop trying to get around. Look at the team. The team is just so over the moon for the first win of this season. Now, look, I can say if they were to knocked off, that would have been their 10th win. They probably wouldn't have been this excited. But regardless, I love to see that the celebration just for a win. Can you imagine a championship if they were to lock one down? Like, I look back on my career and look and say, man, I should have done better. Just a win alone in the 450 class is huge. I know we've talked about this on the show before, but I love to see this because everybody's embracing it. The wins don't come easy. Everybody's working so hard for this point right here, what we're watching on the replay of the team, just putting in all their effort and being able to come out on top. I love to see it because our sport needs more of that. I think that the riders need to embrace these wins and because they don't come as often as maybe they should for some of these riders. And, it's motivating, you know, it's exciting to see, even for me that has done it, won everything. I'm watching now and say, that's really cool to see that, see these guys celebrate like they are. because it's a huge feat just to get one win, let alone a championship. So we're watching Max in the replay here. Actually, I thought his bike quit right there.
Did you?
Watching the race live, I'm like, dude, what's going on? Did it stop running? Is it bogging? Or did he just have to take his time through the whoops there? Because you could see Jet come right up next to him. Got half a bike wheel up through him. So point right there, right before the finish.
Yeah. I could see how you could. Yeah, you would
see
have,
it.
You
kind of looks like he was the bike was laboring of some sort, you know. So, but then he comes out, gets back down on the straightaway, and pulls away and gets himself. Yeah, there's RJ.
I think if Jet does, so we're watching the replay last lap. Jet gets right. I think if Jet doesn't slip right here, I think he wins the race.
Very well could have. Yeah, ran him up high in the turn before. Yeah. But he, Max was just smart enough to hold that line. Hunter or Jet was able to have much more speed and come up, but actually put him on the outside of the turn, so he could not turn down. So he had to wait for Max to get into the rut, come out of it. And then at that point, he was too much on the side of the tire in part of the track that nobody had really been. And that's why you watched the rear tire slide out.
Yep. It was, it's cool to see these emotions. It's cool to see it. I'm with you.
I love it.
And without going into it too much, I just feel like, one of the reasons they're celebrating so much, RV, is because there's so many more guys compared to our day that have an opportunity to win. And so when you do get a win, you know, I think it means, not that it means more, but it's special. It's special because the depth is so much there. It is there. That's what I think, you know.
I think so too. And look, I think these guys, if they go knocking off 11 wins in one season, like you're going to get complacent, you know. 9, 10, 11 wins, you know, or, you know, that's, to me, those are great. Those are all exciting moments, but you start getting those repeats, you know, the excitement starts to come down a bit just because it's, I guess, expected. Nothing is expected in motorcycle racing. So I hope to see that if these guys start knocking off wins, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 a season, that they still have that same excitement when they're done, because I love to see it as an ex-racer, as a guy that's retired. And I know the fans are even more pumped on it than even I am. So, and those are the ones we need to speak to the fans, you know. I'm stoked to see it.
That's right. Hey, real quick, AZ_guy_387. And he says, I'm wrong. Carter Busher. Sorry, AZ guy. What's the most memorable mud race of your careers? Number one, I hated racing in the mud, so I don't have any that I really like. There's a couple that stuck out for me. Obviously, Millville, when I lapped the field, that was cool. And then two other. And then the next one would be 2006 San Francisco. I didn't even win. Bubs won. But dude, I just remember it was so deep and like the mud was heavy and we were just straight up racing. I mean, I think we lapped up the third actually. And, wow. That one was brutal. So those two for me, what about for you?
Yeah. So I raced 2006 San Fran, pulling the whole shot and jumped the finish and cased it and crashed right away for lap one. So,
I don't remember that.
Yeah, I ended up sending it off the finish line and got all squirrely and ended up, would have been fine if I didn't land on the safety deck. The finish line landing had a bit of a safety deck, and that's what really kind of got me. And I landed and it like almost low sided off or high sided off into the tough blocks. So not the greatest memory there, but definitely a major mud race. I want to say Nathan won that one for KTM. Mm-hmm. And then I always got to go back to Daytona. I think it was 08 when Chad's bike quit. I believe I was leading and rode up a tough block right at mechanics area, like literally the tough blocks that mechanics areas that blocks the mechanics. Somehow I ended up offline, front wheel went up on it, fell over, canard won. And that's the weekend that we had like 4 or 5 foot, you know,
dude,
that were filled with water.
I remember that was, dude.
KDub won that, I think.
You could have rode jet skis straight up, because that was your like the design. We dug into the track
and the whole dug down, and then we had torrential downpours, and every low spot was 3-4 feet of water. So like we were racing, and we literally you'd come up to a section and you'd have to like come up fast and you'd jam the brakes on, and then you'd have to like hydroplane wheelie across everything because it'd come up to the radiators in them. So air boxes are down, get kind of down low by the seat there. So the last thing you want to do is suck water up through some of that, you know, all the electronics and all that. So treacherous conditions, I will tell you that.
Yeah, that was brutal. I'm still kind of tripping on. I didn't realize you're at San Fran.
That
was a brutal day. All right. It's that time of the show. Quad lock question of the week. Remember, quadlockcase.com. We had some previous winners. They are super stoked on what they've got. And they have a little extra prize in there also that they give to these lucky winners. And our winner this week is with the question is Anthony Arena. It's at Anthony Arena 95. And Anthony's question is this. What are your thoughts on Austin Forkner and his future? Do you think despite all of the injuries and mishaps, he can still come back and win a 250 title and maybe even onto the 450s? Or do you think his career timeline has been too severely affected at this point? Take a crack at it.
So I do think that it's definitely been affected. I don't know. Anything can happen. It's racing, but man, the number one thing is the kid needs to stay healthy and make smart decisions. And from what I'm seeing currently, or what I saw at Anaheim 1, that super bad decision on his part. You know, we talked about this, I believe, show one a little bit, where, you know, he left the gate and was already behind all those riders, and he decided to stay in it. And that's just a poor decision on his part. So, you know, you move up to the 450 class, you can't have any of those mistakes. You know, those guys will just eat you up, let alone you crash harder on a 450. The bike, you know, the racing's a lot tougher. So, you know, for me, like, Austin has showed a huge potential in his racing, and he's fast, and he's beat Jet, like it's not that he doesn't have the speed, but you know, he's been at this for quite a while right now. So I am going to have to lean on the side of, or going to say that I think that, not that his career is over. But as for 450, I will scratch that off. I don't think that his 450 career is going to be sweet. But I think there is some time that in the lights class, because he is such a veteran, that if he can get his stuff together for next year, that he potentially could have a shot at winning a championship. But it really comes down to the mistakes that he makes and the decisions that he makes also.
The decisions. I'm with you. I think the decisions lead to the mistakes.
Yep. You know, so I don't want to count the kid out, you know, like, but
because he's fast, dude. He was fast. He was fast this year.
Yep, fast. He's got the talent. Like, he blitzes the whoops, jumps all the jumps. Like, he's one of the best guys out there, one of the better guys out there, but bad decisions on his part. So to change that trajectory of, you know, this many years of making bad decisions is sometimes really, really, really hard to do. And number one, you got to be able to listen to whoever you're going to bring into your circle, if it's your team or your trainer or your mentor, you know, really, really work on that. And that's something that I don't see so much of.
And you can't be afraid to change up exactly everything that you're doing. You got to be open to looking of finding ways. And sometimes even if you make a change, it might not be better, but I don't think you should leave any stone unturned. You're going to make poor decisions. I've made decisions that I'm not proud of in my racing. But you keep trying things, and that's how you get that knowledge. And I think, you know, having Barcia on and him explaining why the people that he's working with and who he has worked with in the past and why he chooses to be and work with the people he has now is because he has that experience and he's put it all together. So I'm with you. It sucks because the guy is a massive talent. I mean, To your point, he jumps everything. He's the fastest guy majority of the time. He has a talent, but you also,
and it's really hard to get somebody to, I feel like in his position, it's really hard to get somebody to come down from that. Like even Justin, like it's taken him so many years to figure that out. Like, hey, I need to actually hold back. I need to be smarter in these positions. I'm not going to run it in on this guy. To Austin, like it's really hard to get somebody to, because once you slide the helmet on, goggles, 30 second boards up, all that goes out the window, right? So it's just it's really hard to get somebody to change their racing aspect of it, because you know, as you know, it's everything kind of goes out the window once the gate drops. Our minds almost go blank. But yeah, we work off of repetition, because we have thousands and thousands and thousands of laps. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's what we rely on. If you rely on trying to think while coming into the first turn, you need to react. You can't think first. You got to react. And that's really something that's really hard to do, to get somebody later in their career to rethink all of that.
Well, thank you, Anthony, for that question. That was a really great question. Great insight and analysis on that RV too. I felt like RV would be the great guy to answer your question, Anthony. And I second, I'm right on par with what Ryan had to say. So we appreciate that. Make sure you DM us also. We'll get you dialed in. Dude, I'm looking forward to Nashville. Haven't been there since 2019. Couple reasons. It's a really fun city. I know you like that place. I get to see a couple of our bosses from a couple sponsors from Boxo USA. Our boss from there is going to be there. And then, of course, from United Motorsports, our boss from there is also going to be there. So always love getting that FaceTime with all of them, and we appreciate them. United Motorsports, unitedmotorsports.com. Check them out. And, of course, BoxoUSA.com. Remember, the promo code TITLE24, 10% off site-wide. So looking forward to hanging out with them, having some beverages, and hosting them at Nashville. But going into that race, I think Mother Nature is going to be the big thing. But huge week on NBC. You can see it right there on the screen. Another big week. Thursday starts SMX Insider with Wygant and Daniel Blair on YouTube. They will talk to Max Anstie. That should be good. Make sure you check that out. Of course, Saturday, race day live starts at 9:30 Eastern. Remember, this is a day race. And then round 15 from Nashville is going to be on at 3 p.m. On big NBC. So that is awesome. There's another shot right there. And it's followed by the SMX Insider post-race show. That's always fun. We kind of break it down. And then, of course, Sunday, MotoGP in Spain at 2 p.m. Eastern time on CNBC, or you can watch it live at 8 on MotoGP.tv. Then at 3, IndyCar Series is at Barber, and that's live on Peacock, and our man Lee Diffie is going to be on the call for that. So I'll be tuned in for sure to MotoGP and that IndyCar at Barber. I wish I could get over there, but I'm going to have to watch it on the Peacock app. But that's the times there. Like I said, huge weekend for NBC and motorsports in general. Outside of Mother Nature, I think, let's see, it's 250 East. I think Hunter's going to get his first AMA championship. I think he's going to lock it up.
I think so, too. They both rode super smart in that mud. You know, that's being in their position. That's kind of a crappy spot to be in. You know, you great day of practice, you know, qualifying, heat races were awesome. And then all of a sudden, boom, it sets in, it rains. So that's always a treacherous, the worst thing that happened for a guy like that is the rain, you know? So, they made it through, they got through it in stellar fashion. And then we're coming into Nashville, potential some rain too, but, it'll be awesome to see Hunter get his first championship. I know he's had some ups and downs when he first started over here with some injuries, but cleaned it all up. And, man, he came out swinging this year, most consistent and best I think I've seen him so far being here in the States. So he's well-deserved.
Yeah, isn't it cool to see guys like that? And kind of to Barcia as well, like you have these low points. And then to be able to come back from not being at a good spot man, to do that mentally, it shows you how tough those guys are. Zach Osborne was one of those guys as well. Like, he just kind of came out and, dude, started winning championships. It's cool to see that.
Yep.
Yeah. 450, I think a lot of the same. I think it's protection mode. We're getting down here to the wire. Anything can happen. We know that. But, again, great to have Justin Barcia on. That was good. That was good.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. Always awesome to get those guys on, get their insight, you know, and kind of see, you know, you can talk to him and see he looked very relaxed. He's not, you know, stressed. He's not like, dude, I need to get, you know, figure this out. I think he's figured it out, got his first win of the season, which was awesome to see. And I think these guys, like you, to your point of what you said about these guys riding a little protective, timid of, you know, Eli and Coop coming in, they're racing for a championship, and you have Chase that's a bit far back, you know, in Justin's position, like, I think it's a great spot to be sitting to potentially you know, win a few more of these before we wrap this up at Utah.
That's right. That's right. Well, this is the saddest part of the show when it's time to say goodbye. Everyone, thanks for watching and listening. We appreciate you. We appreciate all of our partners, of course, United Motorsports, Foxo and Quadlock, all of our fans. We appreciate the interaction. It's been a lot of fun being able to read your questions. Remember to check us out wherever you watch or listen. You can check us out on demand on Peacock or Motorsports on NBC's YouTube page. That'll be on Tuesday, or you can rewatch stuff as well. And of course, if you're listening, all your favorite podcast sites. So we appreciate you guys. And RV, we're going to do it again next week, and we'll see everyone in Nashville. Thanks for tuning in.
Hi, folks. Lee Diffie from NBC Sports here. If you truly enjoyed what you just watched, you can get more news, interviews, and highlights by subscribing to the Motorsports on NBC YouTube page. You can get it all, so go for it.